Dr. Christensen.
Yes.
Thank you for agreeing to have a chat with us and a catch up.
Absolutely.
Over on the Hearing Tracker YouTube channel to fill in the world, hopefully, when we're allowed to release this on the new tech that you guys have got out. And this is about a month in advance, so we're at CES 2025 at the moment. And you are the only traditional hearing aid manufacturer here, which brings me great delight and says something about how excited you are about what's coming in the future. So, what is coming in the next 12 months?
Well, you know, the hot topic in audiology and in hearing aids is artificial intelligence. So, and we've seen some artificial intelligence come out. Hearing aids have actually had artificial intelligence for quite some time. But when we talk about deep neural networks, you know, we're really starting to just see the beginning of a deep neural network. And we've been working on it for a long time. I think that, you know, the best way to put it for you is you can have it all.
And I think, do you mean by that? That sounds exciting.
Yeah, well, you know, we've been working on hearing and noise and improving hearing and noise for people who use hearing aids for a very long time. Gradual improvements over the years. What we don't want to do is, you know, improve hearing and noise by compromising other things. And so, you know, people want small devices. They want comfortable devices. They want all day wear time for their rechargeable batteries. And so we needed to get to a point with our deep neural network that we could launch it without compromise. And so you can have it all.
And so those, you mentioned two compromises there that we might have seen from other hearing aid manufacturers that I won't mention. So number one is size. So how big are we talking in terms of these hearing aids compared to, say, Nexia?
They're around the same size as our micro receiver in the ear from Nexia. Yep. And we have added a second chip. So we have that deep neural network chip. We've also done some redesign on the microphones and added microphone covers now on that. So otherwise, it's very similar to the micro receiver in the ear product that we have with Nexia today.
And what's the theory behind the microphone covers as well? Are they interchangeable? Will patients be expected to change those?
They could, but just simple in the field replacement so that if anything gets into the microphones that they wouldn't need to go in for repair. So it's just something that people have been requesting and just something we decided to make sure that this design had that. And also we added that second chip in there.
Okay. And the other thing you mentioned about not compromising is also the battery life as well. So I know that with some other manufacturers, again, not to be mentioned, one of the compromises is the amount of time that the artificial intelligence can actually be active and working.
Yep.
Otherwise, that limits the daily use of the hearing aid. So what are you promising with your new tech?
Well, so, you know, no one would use it like this, but you can turn on the AI chip and the deep neural network for 10 hours. And
wow. Okay.
And so for daily use, you know, we're going to say 20 hours of daily use and some combination of using the intelligent focus, which is our deep neural network AI, and streaming. So when you do those kind of power-hungry things, we believe that in a normal daily use, you're going to get 20 hours out of a hearing aid.
Okay.
So, yeah. So we just didn't want to do this without with those kind of compromises. So,
and that would include Bluetooth streaming as well and using that to an extent.
Yep, absolutely. So that includes with Bluetooth Low Energy Audio, which is where they're equipped, and Auracast and those streaming. So the streaming and the intelligent focus certainly are more power hungry, but it's going to do typical. So, I mean, here at CES, you'd probably need it on 8 hours in those exhibitions, but that's not normal use. But you'd be fine in there with this all day if you really wanted to.
You mentioned, you just brushed over, which is actually a big part of this tech as well, LE Audio and Auracast. And you were telling me earlier that we've also seen a bit of an update in the app for Auracast. So do you want to expand on that?
Yeah, I would say that's something I'm incredibly excited about. So we actually have the first Auracast Assistant in an app by a hearing aid company. So what does that mean? That means if you go someplace where there is Auracast, you'll be able to just open the app and you'll be able to just look at your Auracast Assistant, and it will tell you all of the Auracast streams that are available, and you can choose the one that you like. You see that in some Android phones today.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Not a lot of them, but we wanted to just make it available for anybody because we are slowly but surely starting to see a little bit of Auracast out there. So,
so one question, again, regarding Auracast is, for anybody that doesn't know what Auracast means, what does that mean in practice? Is it just reserved for hearing aid users? Will it be for other people with, say, normal earbuds or headphones as well? What will people experience on a daily basis?
Yeah, so it is part of a new Bluetooth standard. So I think everybody knows Bluetooth. We all use it with our phones and our cars. But Bluetooth has, you know, it has come out with a new protocol. So Bluetooth Classic is what we have today, and now we'll have Bluetooth Low Energy Audio. And it was actually the hearing industry that kind of got them to do it. And we asked for a lower power consumption Bluetooth, and we asked for a public broadcast. And ultimately, they Bluetooth special interest group said, okay, we'll do it. But they, in their developing, they felt like it was a better Bluetooth for many reasons, better sound quality. And then they felt like the broadcast audio could be for anybody. And so what'll happen, I mean, in real life, I mean, you'll be able to go maybe watch a football game in a bar, and you'll be able to find the stream, your Auracast stream from that TV, and you'll be able to listen to it in your earbuds, your cochlear implants, your hearing aids, anything that's equipped with Bluetooth Low Energy Audio.
Okay, so yeah. This is a game changer in the world of, well, anything,
yeah.
Really.
Yeah. It is a complete game changer. Yeah. We actually pretty recently did an Auracast event at Lincoln Center in New York City, and did it during a symphony there, and it was incredible. Yeah.
So I guess the other question I got for you is, all other manufacturers are boasting that they've got Auracast, but no one has yet activated it. Have ReSound?
Yes.
So it's working in both Nexia and the newest tech that's coming out.
Yep.
Remind me of the name for this video.
ReSound Vivia.
Vivia, thank
yep.
you.
Yep.
Should know that. Should mention that at least once in the video as well. Okay, cool. And so if these Auracast transmitters start to be installed across the globe, of which the last information I heard on this, I think there were 6 in the US alone.
Yeah,
so
that,
we're still
that could be.
Really early in the stage of this technology rolling out.
Yep.
We're going to see all of these changes, and it's going to be fantastic.
Yeah, I mean, there's no doubt about it. I mean, we used our TV streamers to do the one at Lincoln Center. We actually used our TV
streamers. What's the range on these things?
Enormous. What is it? 25 meters, something like that. Wow. I can't remember. Okay. Don't quote me on that. But it's a long way. We did not lose the stream in the concert hall all the way to the back. The sound quality, I'm normal hearing. And I, of course, had hearing aids, and I kept putting them in and out and in and out.
Yeah.
It was better with the aids in.
Wow.
I was like, okay, it just sounds better. Because it was, you know, we had that TV streamer closer, and then it was plugged into the soundboard. So you were getting the whole mix right in your ears. And I mean, it was completely mind-blowing.
And I
think one of the reasons why we haven't seen a lot of, you know, public places having them is, you know, we really haven't had the public broadcast systems, but Amplitronic now is finally putting out public broadcast systems. So I think it's so easy to, you know, put these in anywhere. I mean, you just need a transmitter.
This is my next question. So
yeah.
I guess people are going to have in the back of their minds the century-old loop systems that have been doing a great job for a very long time, and a lot of people swear by them, and they do brilliant jobs. But at the same time, they're only as good as how well they're maintained, and they're pretty expensive to install as well.
Yep.
So is there a lot of maintenance necessary from an Auracast transmitter point of view, and are they expensive to install?
Yeah, so no on either count. I mean, you're going to have these public broadcasts that are even, you know, the range is going to be much further because of the more power that's driving it in the commercially available. And you'll just have to put one of them up, and then all you need is an Auracast Assistant to find that stream. And it's nothing like looping. I mean, and looping is pretty limited, because if you have a really big area, I mean, you have to loop the floor. You have to.
Or you have dead spots, and so it's not as effective. Yeah.
Yeah. And the sound quality, although, you know, really game changing for many, many years, the sound quality is really not good compared to Auracast.
You guys are definitely, from my understanding, leading on the Auracast front, which is very exciting.
Yeah.
Someone needs to do it. Needs to be driven. It needs to be pushed.
You know, it's the partnerships that we have. You know, Microsoft. We've worked with Microsoft to implement Bluetooth Low Energy Audio into computers, And we've been out there and we fit engineers at Microsoft and really just watch them be able to take Teams calls for the first time. All of that's available today on that Evo chip. If you have an Intel Evo chip and then Windows or Microsoft 10 or Windows 10, I think it is. But you can do that today. So there are low energy audio things that can benefit the hearing impaired today. And then as Auracast kind of comes online, mm-hmm. which I think 2025 is going to be a big year for Auracast.
I mean, if it's as easy to install as you've said, then it's got to start somewhere,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly.
How, I guess it, the place it's got to start is with the venues being interested in installing these things, though.
Yeah.
Is there anything happening behind the scenes to try and encourage people to do that you know of?
I don't think we are as a company, but I think you see interest, many places. Just yesterday here, they had a accessibility and they had Auracast in all the rooms. Did you know that?
I did not know that.
Yeah. So okay. they had five
being
or
transmitted
six.
Or working then.
Yeah. So they had put them in. I don't know what company they used here at CES, but they actually had transmitters and we had hearing aids there for people to try. But that entire accessibility afternoon was all broadcast through Auracast in those rooms.
Wow.
Yeah.
Awesome. One last question. When is all this going to be available?
So it's end of February. You will see the big launch of this product. And it is phenomenal. So I really hope people will try it.
Thank you for your time today.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks.